So in previous videos, I've introduced the sequential consistency model. I've said that this is perhaps the most intuitive way for a programmer to write programs. But then you will also need some hardware support to make sure that your ultimate execution is sequentially consistent. Okay, and that includes the hardware preserving program order, which means that you can no longer reorder loads and stores. Okay, and that can be really bad for performance, right? So to overcome that performance problem, I introduced a few optimizations last time that were transparent to the programmer. Okay, so in hardware, I was issuing a load early, and then I was checking it later before it committed to make sure that the value was the same, right? So those are optimizations which speed up performance, but these are optimizations that the programmer doesn't have to worry about. Okay, now in this video, I'll introduce another way to overcome this performance problem, but this is a hardware-software approach which does get exposed to the programmer. Okay, so I'm going to introduce a relaxed consistency model, which allows the hardware to do some reorderings, but this is something that the programmer has to be aware of and has to write programs to be able to tolerate these reorderings. Okay, so let me make that clear shortly. So let's first go back to this example and understand, why these problems happen. Why did I have all these examples where a violation of programming order led to a violation of sequential consistency? So if you look at this example here, P1 and P2, and you'll see that, both of these threads are dealing with the same variables. They're both dealing with variables A and B, and these variables are not being protected with a lock. Okay, so both threads could be accessing the same variables at the same time, and at least one of these accesses happens to be a write. Okay, and that's called a race condition. So if your program has race conditions, any reorderings that you do that might be safe within that single thread end up being unsafe in a global context because there's a second thread which is also accessing these same values. Okay, so what it means is, if my code did not have races, right? So if thread T1 was dealing with variables A, B, C, and thread T2 was dealing with variables P, Q, R, there's no race condition in this case. We are dealing with completely different values, in which case, any kinds of reorderings that you want to do should be perfectly safe, right? So here's an example where, you can have optimizations. Here's a part of the program where you can let your out of order processor loose and you can have it do any kinds of optimizations that it wants. Okay, but then later you might enter a region of code where there could be race conditions, where T1 is perhaps touching variables, A, B, C. T2 is perhaps touching variables, B, C, P. So in this case, there is a possible race condition. And in this case, you have to be more careful, right? So if the programmer can demarcate these regions of code, saying here's a region where there should be no race conditions, the hardware can then proceed with doing all kinds of reorderings. And then when you get to a region of code which has races, the programmer needs to somehow demarcate that. And over here, you will then turn off your optimization and say that I need to preserve program order in this case. That allows me to preserve sequential consistency. Okay, so this would be a relaxed consistency model where the programmer is involved in letting the hardware know, where it is okay to do reorderings and where it is not. Okay, and these demarcations are usually done with something called a fence instruction. It is a special instruction saying that you cannot look beyond this point. You have to finish everything until this point before you can proceed with the next instruction. And this is because, I do care about program order at this point of time. Okay, so let me show you another example over here. Let me first draw out one example here. So here I'm touching variables, A, B, C, P, Q, R. These are all ordinary instructions. The hardware says, it should be safe to do reorderings. Let me do that. Then I start entering a region of code where you could have races. So over here, when I touch variable A, I'm going to make it a special fence instruction, which says that, let me execute this instruction as a standalone isolated instruction. Let me make sure that everything before this is finished. Then I'll execute this. Then I'll look beyond this point. And the next instruction could be another fence instruction that deals with B and so on. So each instruction is being executed, sequentially one at a time. And this helps preserve my sequential consistency model. And hopefully, I execute this fenced part of the code for a small fraction of overall execution time. If I did this throughout, then, my performance is going to be really bad. But my hope is that I spend, most of my time in these regions where there are no race conditions and I get really high performance. Okay, here's an alternative way to implement this. So once I identify my racy code, instead of marking each of those instructions as a fence instruction, I could say that, let me acquire a lock which makes sure that I'm the only one that gets in over here. Okay, so there's a lock being acquired because I'm entering a racy part of the program. And then when I'm done with that code, I then release the log that lets somebody else get into their racy part of the code. And then, you know, when they leave it, somebody else can enter. Okay, so if I do it this way, now, you know, each of these instructions does not have to have a fence. You know, each of these instructions need not be marked as a fence instruction. All I need to do is make sure that, you know, the lock is surrounded by two fences. Okay, so before I acquire the lock, I'm going to make sure that everything before me has finished completely. Its effect has been propagated to all of the other threads. Then I acquire the lock. Then, only after the lock is acquired, do I then enter my critical section or my racy code. Okay, so I enter this code only when I'm sure that no one else is executing or dealing with these same variables. So now once I get into the racy code, again, I can do all kinds of reorderings over here. Okay, because there's no one else touching these same variables. I'm guaranteed of that because I have the lock. And so now I can do, you know, out of order execution over here. I can do out of order execution over here. It's only when I, you know, cross the boundary from here to here that I have to make sure that everything before has finished. I've acquired the lock. Only then can I start executing these instructions. And now these instructions can be executed in out of order fashion. Then before I release the lock, I have to make sure that everything before me has finished. All of those writes have been propagated to everyone else. Then I can proceed with releasing the lock. Okay, so, you know, this is perhaps the most efficient way to write your program. And the only additional burden that it introduces on the programmer is to be careful about where you're accessing shared variables, and to make sure that those accesses are protected with locks. Once that is done, the compiler or the library can make sure that, you know, that those lock acquires and those lock releases are surrounded by these fence instructions. Okay, and if those fence instructions are provided, we are guaranteed that, you know, any kinds of reorderings are safe as long as you don't go past the fences until previous instructions have finished. Okay, so this is a way to improve performance because you can do all kinds of optimizations here, all kinds of optimizations over here. It is only when crossing the boundaries that you have to be careful. And it is up to the programmer to use locks and hence convey to the hardware where those boundary crossings are happening. Okay, so that concludes the discussion of consistency models. You know, just to do a really quick recap, we want to provide sequential consistency to make things easier on the programmer. Preserving that at the hardware level leads to performance losses. To overcome that performance loss, you can either introduce some hardware optimizations, or you can introduce some hardware-software optimizations, which involve the programmer as well, right? And that's the last thing that we just saw, where the programmer has to be careful when they use shared variables and make sure that they are protected with locks.